Folks, welcome to the unMANly podcast. This is your host, Coach Acie. LV was supposed to be in the call, but unfortunately he's not here today. But I do have a very special guest here today. He is the conscious coach, or the unconscious coach, Roberto Martinez, a life coach, master NLP practitioner. His focus, according to his website, theunconsciouscoach.ca. Did I have that correct?
Yeah, I'm in the middle of revamping it, but yes, that is what it is.
Yeah, so on your website, what jumped out right at me was that you teaching men how to create permanent change. Okay, So before I get into that, I just want to welcome you to the show. And I want you to tell me, like, what I'm interested in is why you got into men's work.
Why I got into men's work? It's so funny, man. Like, this is a question that, you know, people have asked me, and I've had so many different answers to that question. But the truth is, man, is it's on my heart. Like, I just feel compelled to work with men because I know what it's like to feel like a boy in a man's body, you know, where on the outside, it seemed like I had all my shit together. But on the inside, I was completely terrified of asking for what I want, terrified of claiming what I want and actually taking it, terrified of approaching the woman I was attracted to. Like, I know what it's like to be that man crippled by fear, and overcoming that has been one of the greatest gifts I've ever given myself. And in overcoming that myself, I just feel compelled to help men grow through that themselves. So
when did you come to the realization of all this though? Was there like a point? Was there like a turning point? Was there like a point in your life or something happened?
Well, I would say that there was many points. I wouldn't say that there's just one. The point that stands out, actually, to be more specific about when was the point that pushed me to work with men, was maybe about a little under a year ago. I like felt it on my heart to work with men, but I was incredibly resistant to it. Like, at that point in my career, I was working with a lot of women. Like,
oh, really?
To be honest, like, all of my clients were women. It was so fascinating, but I still felt this like need, this desire to help men step into their power. Because I feel like there's a lot of support for women right now in today's day and age, and as there should be, right?
Yeah, for sure. There's a lot of, I mean, statistics around, you know, support for mental health programs and how they're usually just more, or women are more receptive, I think, to help. And they're the ones who are seeking help and seeking these services. Whereas men, you know, typically, as you know, are suffering in silence for the most part. So for up until a couple of years ago, like, men's mental health wasn't even a thing.
Well said. Suffering in silence. Mm-hmm. And the turning point was when I noticed that, like, that whisper, you know, the dream that we want to achieve, it's always like a whisper. It's never loud in our face. That whisper was like telling me like to do this, but that whisper is typically attached to your biggest fear. I did not feel I was adequate enough. I didn't feel like I was man enough to be a leader of men. And through that process of examining that, I was really, really forced to learn how to let go of that belief, which is what NLP is all about.
Right? So there's that whole idea of feeling man enough. I think that's like the whole premise of this actual podcast, because it's called the unMANly podcast. And I don't think any man or any maybe unconscious man wants to be calling himself unMANly. It's just a label and a title that, you know, we've spent our whole lives just, you know, trying to, you know, overcompensate and try to get away from. So I noticed that you've been doing a lot of like relationship work and a lot of marriage work. You and I actually have something in common. We're both actually divorced, and we both actually have a son around the same age too. So I think there's a lot of experiences that we probably shared together. So I just want to ask you, you know, you're doing a lot of work in relationships and marriage. Like, I coach too, but I don't actually work with couples. Like, I mean, I have a lot to say about couples, and I think I could. But I just want to ask you, like, what do you think about the current state of like relationships and marriages right now, like the modern? Because I know you're all about modern. A lot of your branding is about modern. So tell me about modern relationships.
Yeah. So are we talking about modern relationships in general, or are we talking about modern relationships in the context of this quarantine?
No, not about the quarantine. Let's talk about it in general.
Yeah. Okay, in general. Yeah. Okay, cool. So I think that the state of modern, I think there's two sides of it. There's the relationship where two partners on the outside seem like they have it all together. They seem to have the dream life, the dream relationship, yet they don't really know how to communicate. Or I should say, they're both terrified and or terrible at communicating what they actually want and need. So they stuff it under the rug, okay? And they're really good at stuffing it under the rug until eventually the rug is so big that they can't ignore it any longer. And I find symptoms of that kind of relationship are couples who feel very distant. There's little to no intimacy. And intimacy does not mean sex, right? Like it can, and that's amazing, but little to no intimacy means there's like very little real deep connection. Or another symptom of that is bickering over the same things over and over and over again.
Why is the communication so bad then?
Well, the communication is bad because if I'm afraid, so let's imagine if I'm with someone and I'm afraid to truly express my needs, wants, and desires, right? That means I'm holding myself back from actually communicating what I need. Mm. So if I'm not telling my partner what it is that I need, how can we have an intimate relationship? Like intimacy inherently, like if you break it down, it's into me, you see. But in order for you to see me, I got to express myself. I got to open up my heart so you can see into me.
But if I don't... yourself though too, right? Is that like, how does someone know what they need then in relationships? Because I think sometimes people have problems communicating is because they don't know themselves that well, or they don't have that self-love a little bit too.
That's right.
So now we're peeling back even one more layer then, right? So
that's
right. It's a lot of work that you do that when it comes to, you know, the relationships is getting people to take a longer look at themselves and, you know, examining that self-love and what those self-needs might actually be.
Yeah. So that, what you just said, is like the key, right? It's understanding yourself and not judging yourself, because the not expressing yourself is a symptom of a deeper problem. And that deeper problem is typically some form of self-rejection. So for example, if I have a lot of shame attached to my sexual desires, then why would I share that with my partner? Because if I've rejected it within myself, then I'm going to assume that they reject it. Right? Because we see the world through the lens of what we believe. So if I reject this part of myself, then I definitely can assume that you're going to reject it, right? So step one to having a thriving, amazing relationship is you got to learn to love and accept yourself unconditionally. And that happens very intentionally and deliberately. That does not happen by accident, right? So you need to, I think everyone, this goes for people in relationships, out of relationships, we have to have a self-love and self-acceptance practice that we do every single day to show ourselves that we love ourselves unconditionally. And then through that, we attract the amazing relationship that we want, right?
There's so much to be said about self-love in itself. Like, I feel like I could just go on and about that forever. But, you know, I was reading one of your Facebook posts recently. It was probably just about a week or so ago. And in quotations, I'm going to say, quote unquote, "I used to be someone who had so much value of my own value tied to sex. If we're having lots of delicious, passionate lovemaking, then I felt like a worthy man. And if we weren't, then it meant that my partner was going to leave me and have her sexual desires filled by someone else. So this was the story I used to play in my head during all my relationships. And through quarantine, there were a few moments where the old story actually started to resurface. So I guess some of this started coming back up. This really resonated with me, because I was one of those guys too, who felt that if I wasn't, you know, talking to women or having sex with men and picking up women, I did not feel manly at all. Like, I felt very unworthy. I tied that to insecurity and to jealousy when I was in relationships.
Yeah.
And it was just, I was acting a fool, man. It was just coming out, and it was, you know, the relationship was toxic. A lot of it was my fault too, I'm sure. And you know, a lot of this really opened my eyes up to, you know, what makes a relationship successful, because obviously I had a marriage and it failed. So, can you paint us a picture actually of like what this was like for you during that time? Like, how bad did it actually get for you before things got better?
Oh man, how bad did it get? Well, it led to a messy divorce, you know? And first of all, just on a side note, I just want to thank you for having me on the show. It's really nice to connect with you, brother.
Oh, of course, dude.
Honored to be here.
Hey, feelings mutual, man.
So how bad was it, man? Well, the problem with my past sexual desire was it was tangled through the lens of what I thought my partner wanted, right? So everything I did, and like, here's the thing about sex, how you approach sex is typically how you approach life, right? Mm-hmm. Do you approach sex like completely open and raw and uninhibited? You know what the word I'm trying to say is, yeah. You know what I'm saying? You know what I'm trying to say is,
yeah.
Are you completely yourself and okay with being yourself, or are you sheltered, right? Do you have this, because there's so many different layers to sex. There's like the pleaser, the person who's like always giving to their partner, because the more that they give, the more they feel worthy and enough, right? And that was me. Like, I was the giver. I was like the pleasurer. Mm-hmm. Or there's the opposite of that spectrum. There's the taker, the person who is like this crazy, like a dominant. And I'm talking, and this can be both men and women, but we're talking this from the masculine side of things.
Yeah, for sure.
That's the person who just like takes what they want. That's the aggressive person. That's the person who just knows how to fuck.
But just wants to really come, really, right?
Exactly.
And really care about the other person. Yeah.
That's right. There's not much love in that. Now, mind you, I think there's power and beauty in both dynamics. Like, yeah. We all have both of those, all of those in us, and many other spectrums of sexual energy. But the problem I had for a long time, like I said, was everything I did in the bedroom was through the lens of how I thought my partner wanted it to be. So everything was through pleasing them. And in doing that, like, yeah, sure, there were some fun times that we had, but I was never really satisfying my need. I was never really showing up as Roberto. I was showing up as, this is who I think you want Roberto to be. Mm-hmm. It's not even who they want you to be. Like, all women want, really, is for you to be yourself and own it.
For sure. And did you, like, over-pleasure too much, do you find? Because sometimes you might be giving too much, and then they're not ready to take all that, too. So, like, how did that feel?
Yeah, well, I mean, where that would lead to is hey, stop, like, this is too much. And then all of a sudden, because your worth is attached to it, you feel like this.
Oh my God, yeah.
Right? You're like, oh my God, I didn't do it right? Versus those, but the other side of that coin is you do it well, they have this amazing, glorious orgasm, and now you're a fucking king.
Like, yeah, it validates you even more, yeah.
Exactly, and like, that's good for a moment, but long-term, man, that screws you, because then you're constantly seeking that validation.
That's right, and just like we do in so many parts of life, right? Just even outside of sex too, which is, you know, your point where it says that, you know, how you approach sex is kind of how you approach life.
That's right. And that's how I approach life. Like, literally there was a time it clicked where I realized I was working with my business partners at the time, and we were making some pretty big business decisions. And everything I was saying was through the lens of how I thought they wanted me to approach it. And when it clicked, I'm like, holy shit. Like, I had to ask myself, like, okay, what does Roberto want? Like, what do I actually want? And it was a practice of letting go of needing to be a certain way on how people were hoping I am perceived or acting, you know, like, that took a lot of deliberate, intentional action. And to be honest, man, even to this day, I sometimes catch myself in those old patterns, but now I recognize it way more quickly, and I'm able to respond way more effectively because I've made it my intention and my practice to do so.
Yeah. The awareness is definitely there now. So yeah, I was going to ask you, like, where are you now? Because you did mention, you know, the old story kind of tried to resurface a little bit. So you became aware of it. Now, I guess you're quickly able to dismiss it, I guess, or at least, you know, come to peace with why you're feeling the way you do. But like, talk to me a little bit about that process of how you deal with these things now when they resurface.
So recently when it resurfaced, how did I deal with it? First, I had to recognize, okay, where is this trigger actually coming from? Mm-hmm. And then I have to ask myself, is this story I'm telling myself true? Right? Now, mind you, this came after like a few days of literally playing into the story of like, I'm inadequate, I'm insecure, I'm not man enough, right? Whatever the story is. And what I did actually is I chose to add something into my daily practice. So something I used to do, this is when I started my biggest transformation started, is I decided to go to the mirror every day, look at myself dead in the eyes, and pour love into myself. Like, not just like, oh yeah, like self-love. Like, no, literally look at myself in the eyes and be like, you are amazing. Like, you deserve the absolute best in this world. And I would set a timer for like a minute and I did it every single day. And dude, you'd be surprised how uncomfortable that is.
Like, it is, no, I can for sure.
It blows my mind. Like, why is pouring that kind of love and intention into myself uncomfortable? Like, I can do that for you. Like, if you call me and you're having a bad day, right? Like, dude, I'll easily give you amazing love. I'll pump your tires. I'll do everything I can to empower you. But the second I need to do that to myself, it's uncomfortable. Like, that's a problem, you know? And so what I did when it resurfaced is I started to re-implement that practice. Right, I started to make sure that every day in the morning, I take time in the mirror, look at myself in the eyes. And the key is, it's not just about saying the words. It's about really doing your best to feel it. Like, get your body involved, like move, you know? And that was a big transformative piece for me, is reintroducing that back into my life. Because then it has me focused on the story that I want to be telling myself, which is
You meditate too, right?
Every day.
Yeah.
Every day. Yeah.
That must be a nice combination of the two for sure.
Yeah.
Because I find them, that's what I've been doing to kind of soothe like how I feel about things. You know, I often run into a lot of conflicts with people at work where, you know, my opinions have to get matched up against other opinions. And, you know, you always want to feel superior when that kind of stuff happens. Even with girls too, you want to get validated. So there's many times, and I'm in a very similar place right now where I'm extremely aware of what's happening around me and my feelings and how I'm reacting to things. So I just got to be extremely careful when these things happen. And my meditative practices has allowed me to like kind of slow things down a little bit.
Huge.
Like when things come at me. Yeah. Kind of like the Matrix, you know what I mean? Where you're like dodging those bullets a little bit. So, but it still hurts, man. Cause I've dealt big time in my life. Like I alluded it to earlier about jealousy and insecurity too. And it all stemmed from self-love and self-compassion. Maybe a lot of it from my childhood too. I did a lot of that during my therapy after my divorce. I don't know if you actually got some professional help after your divorce too.
I did actually. That was the, so I hired an NLP coach, which inevitably put me on the path to become a master NLP coach myself. Like it was transformative, dude. Like it was incredible.
I wanted to ask you, this is one of the questions I had written down. I wanted to ask you both and LV, and this really will appeal to the greater male population, but you know, why is the way that most men, like, I mean, I guess stereotypically, you know, think about sex, why is that detrimental to us? Why is that bad for masculinity? Why is that bad for men? Is it bad for men? Is anything even good or bad? Like, I don't know. I want to hear your opinions on that.
So define how most men think about sex. What does that mean?
I don't know. I mean, it's the stereotype. It's not what the girls would think about us, that we, you know, we're like a whole bunch of like horned out, you know, horned out guys who just want to have sex or just want to take. I know you and I see things differently, but like, you know, more, most girls think guys are just always just trying to have sex, or, and the guys who used to be validated just by the fact that we were having lots of sex or we were having like beautiful women.
Yeah. So I definitely think that it's unfortunate, but I think that there are a lot of men that, I think one of the biggest problems with the way many men view sex is it's very outcome based. So you fuck to come, right? Mm-hmm. That's it. Like you literally go to a destination. Now, mind you, that's a very masculine view of things in general, right? Like masculine energy is very much like, I see a destination, I'm on the path, I achieve the destination, I'm done. Mm-hmm. Right? Which is inherent in who we are, in masculine energy, which is great. However, the problem sometimes in that is you miss the journey, right? And a big practice of mine, truly a massive practice of mine, is when I'm having sex with my beautiful goddess of a partner, is to let go of it being outcome-based, right? Because if I'm just doing this to achieve something, I'm missing the beauty of the journey. I'm missing the every little detail in the process. And ultimately, like, the best sex any of us have ever had are moments where you've been fully immersed and connected with your partner and with yourself in the present moment now, where time literally stops and you're not focused on anything else other than being with her or him, right? And that's like the goal. And I think that all the most beautiful moments we strive for in life bring us to the present moment, and almost nothing does it like sex.
Yeah.
But you can't be and relish in that moment when you're focused on the outcome.
Yeah, and the journey is the goal, right? Ironically, the journey is the goal.
That's right.
So is that like tantric sex or something like that? Because I mean, I've heard a lot about people talk about tantric sex, and for most people, I'm not an expert on tantric sex at all, but it's really more about the journey than it is the destination. In fact, sometimes you have sex, tantric sex, where there is no coming. So tell me a little bit about that. I think you know a little bit more about that than I do.
Yeah. So the person who's more of an expert than that than me is definitely my partner. So I'll give you guys like my understanding of Tantra. Now the, and again, this is just my understanding. So don't quote me on this. So for anyone who's going to comment, like I'm not an expert at this, but my understanding of Tantra is the ability to be fully present and immersed in whatever you're doing. You can be tantric with the way you play with your kid. We can be tantric in the way we have this conversation. And tantric sex is literally what I had just described. It's that beauty and that beautiful moment where all you are is with your partner. You just feel every like inch of their body and everything just feels so incredibly amazing in that moment. And all you're focused on is being together. You feel so unified. Truly in that moment, you are one, right? And that's-
Are you feeling like that? Like every time you guys are having sex right now?
Not every time, no. Like the thing about sex, man, is that it's a spectrum. It's like I think everything, like one thing that's really consistent about our universe is it tends to move cyclically in seasons, right? So to say that we're always having, now mind you, like if I were being honest, like yes, every time I have sex with my partner, there is a tantric element to it, right? Mm-hmm. Always, because I'm present. All I am is with her, all she is with me, but it's different, right? Like tantric sex could be like the naughty, nasty, dirty talking stuff. And then tantric sex could also be the like passionate lovemaking, right? It all depends really on context. I think it's all really tantric sex.
How do you think couples could like fix their sexual problems? Because I think like, I mean, a lot of couples are having sexual problems. Like, I mean, there's always the stereotype and the notion of like, you know, spicing it up, you know, introducing things into the bedroom and stuff like that. But I feel like you have a different approach when I ask you that question. Like, what's the first thing that couples can do to kind of like fix their sex life?
Well, first, it's all context dependent. So I would say it depends. But if I were to give you a general shotgun blast on how to improve your sex, I first pose the question, what is sex? And to me, sex is the rawest form of expression. So if I want to experience my partner in her full expression, and I want to give myself to her in my full expression, then I need to express myself fully to her, and she needs to express herself fully to me. So outside of the bedroom, what that means is creating a container of safety for my partner to share everything that she could possibly want to share with me, and to treat the gift that is her expression with the kindness and respect that it deserves. And this, the problem arises is, let's say I'm with my partner and she shares something vulnerable with me, and I get triggered, I get jealous, I get insecure, and I react. What I just taught my partner is that her expression is not safe with me. So what? How do you think that's going to translate in the bedroom? Right? Because if she doesn't feel safe to express herself with me, if she doesn't feel safe to share her heart with me outside of the bedroom, then she's going to start to shelter herself, right? She's going to start to shield and put up walls against her heart because she's like, I can't trust you with my heart, right? And then the next time we go into the bedroom, yeah, like I might get off, but she might feel a little disconnected and she's going to hold herself back. And what we all want, we want every single man, when they sleep with their partner, when they sleep with their girlfriend, with their wife, they just want their wife to become in full expression, to be fully open to receive them. But for them to be open, they got to know that they can express themselves. And the same goes for men. I got to know that for me to give all of myself to my partner, I need to be fully expressed. I need to be completely and open, which really comes down to accepting myself fully. Because when I accept myself fully, I express myself fully.
Yeah, I mean, all these problems can really happen outside the bedroom too, where, you know, one partner doesn't feel comfortable sharing, I mean, her emotions about anything, or his or her emotions about anything.
That's right.
And there's a problem outside the bedroom now too. So do you fix the bedroom problems to fix the outside problems, or do you fix the outside problems to fix the bedroom problems?
And again, I think it's context dependent.
Yeah.
And I'll have to get going after this question, brother.
Yeah, for sure.
But what I will say is that, like, I have a friend who says that when him and his partner argue, the first thing he wants to do is have sex, because he feels like that'll bring the walls down and then they can talk after and resolve it.
Interesting.
But I know for myself personally, dude, like, I'm someone where if there is conflict, if I feel there's stuff going on, like, I'm not in a place where I want to go there. right? It'll be forced. I need to let the pain go before I can allow myself to express myself in that way. Like, there needs to be safety for me, you know?
That's amazing, man. Well, hey, let's leave it there because I know you got to go, but we will definitely continue this conversation sometime. I think that was a great start. And yeah. It's my pleasure to have you. We'll speak again for sure. Maybe we'll try to record it, and I hope you have a great night, man.
You too, brother. Thank you for having me.
All right, take care.
Peace.
When things are really tough and they're really rough and nothing's working.
What's up, guys? Coach AC here. Thanks for checking out my video. I really appreciate it. Why don't you stick around for a bit, and I'll see you in the next one. Yeah.